All right. Well, it's really good to be here. I know some of you are thinking, who is this clown? Okay. And so I think it's kind of important that we kind of get into that a little bit. And I'm grateful this for a lapel mic because I talk with my hands and I like to do that. And I don't really like to stand behind a pulpit very much. Okay. But as he said, my name is Randy Whetstone. Okay, for the last about 40 years, I lived in a little town called Claysburg, which is just south of Altoona. Okay, you know where Claysburg is? You were born in Claysburg? What's your name? You were a Dively? Oh, okay, well, if you were born in Claysburg, you're a Dively, a Musselman, or a Lingenfelder, or a Wyatt, or a Walter, yeah. Okay, so imagine that. So, but anyhow, that's where I spend about the last 40 years. So, but I started out, I was very fortunate. I was born into a Christian family, and we were into the Church of God, which was a kind of Pentecostal holiness church. And, you know, we were there every time the door would open. When I was a teenager, I had a drug problem. They drug me to church every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night, okay? And I didn't really like it a whole lot, okay? But, you know, that's what they did. And when I got to be about 16 and knew everything, okay, I decided that you know, they weren't telling me the whole truth, and they were a bunch of hypocrites, and all they were worried about was money and statistics. And so, in my family, the only reason you had to not go to church is you had to get you had to work. If you had to work, then you could not go to church. So I got a job as a busboy at Ed's Steakhouse in Bedford, and I would work Sunday nights, and that would get me out of Sunday nights, and I'd work Wednesday nights, and that would get me out of Wednesday nights, you know. So basically, all I had to do was Sunday morning, okay? And then I got married, and I basically just kind of walked away, and I stayed away from the church till we had kids. And this is my wife, by the way. This is Luann. Okay. We had twin daughters. Okay. They're redheads. They're absolutely beautiful. They're identical twins. And when they got to be about 3 or 4 years old, I said to my wife, I said, these kids need to know about God. You take them to Sunday school. I'll go down to my buddy's house and drink coffee and eat a gob and watch Star Search. Okay. Which is what I did every Sunday morning. Okay. And after a couple of months, weeks, I don't know how long it was, you know, one morning my little girl looks up at me and she says, Daddy, she says, if I have to go to church on Sunday mornings, why don't you? So I had a choice. I could be a hypocrite to my kid or I could go to church. So I chose going to church. Now, church was a Methodist church. We chose that church. I sent my wife there with the girls. The neighbors all went there, you know, and stuff like that. And I knew a little bit about Methodist being a Pentecostal, you know, and as younger. You go there and they don't expect too much out of you. Okay, you just show up on Sunday and you're good to go. Okay, and it's a safe church. You know, you didn't have to worry about anything. You know, so we went to the Methodist church down by the post office. Okay, okay, and that was okay. So when I started going back, you know, it wasn't long until I ran the church. I was the president of the board. I was the president of trustees. I was the president of PPR committee. You know, that's just kind of the personality I am. Okay, you know, if I'm going to be involved in something, I'm going to be involved in it, and I'm going to make sure that it works. Okay, so it wasn't long till I was running it. Okay, and there again, it was safe. Okay, and everything was cool. You know, we were going, and everything was going good, you know, we go to church every Sunday. That's what good people do. Okay? So one day, my wife came to me and she said, there's this event in Pittsburgh called Promise Keepers, and I want you to go to it. I'd like you to go to it. Now, I owned a hardware store, so, I mean, I worked six days a week, sometimes seven, you know. And if I worked, if I went somewhere, somebody had to take my place. Okay, which was her. And so I wasn't real happy with her at that point, and so I decided, okay, I'm going to go. She'll have to work in my place. That'll teach her a lesson, and I'll get out of work for a day and a half. So we go to Three River Stadium. That was Three River Stadium back in those days, and I went actually with a bus from the Church of God in Claysburg, okay, a bunch of those guys, and we went out and just walked into Three Rivers Stadium, and there was about 30,000 men there. I didn't think there were 30,000 Christian men in the world, let alone Western Pennsylvania, okay, and they were singing How Great Thou Art to the top of their lungs. Now, even though I grew up in a Pentecostal church, that was the first time in my life I experienced worship. Because in the Methodist church, we would sing three songs, and that was it, you know. And even when I was in the Pentecostal church as a kid, they were kind of the same type of thing. Now, maybe they were worshiping back then. I just didn't know it because I was a kid, you know. But that's the first time I experienced worship. It hit me. So if in Promise Keepers, they had a theme every year, okay? And this particular theme was reconciliation. Reconciliation of the races, reconciliation of the denominations. Basically, they just said, listen, guys, we all believe in Jesus. Let's just focus on that and go, you know? And so I don't know if you know about him, but there was Reverend Joseph Garlington was speaking. He's a pastor in Pittsburgh. He's kind of pretty well known. He's a black man. And he was speaking on racism. And I'm sitting there in the seat, you know, kind of like, this doesn't have anything to do with me. You know, I'm not a racist. How could I be a racist? I don't know any black people or Asian people or other people. I grew up in Man's Choice. There are no black people. I lived in Claysburg. There are no black people except Lavinia Hollander, and she was this crazy black lady, but she was really sweet, okay? Everybody loved her, okay? How could I be racist, you know? And that's just kind of, I was sitting here kind of fooling myself, just kind of like this, you know. And all of a sudden, there was this voice. And it was right here. And it said, oh, Randy, you're not a racist, are you? And I went, no. And he said, then how come you get that feeling inside when you see a white woman with a black man on television? Busted. Because when I would see that, something would just grit, you know, and the thoughts would come, you know, he should stay with his people, she should stay with her people, you know, what's wrong with him, you know, yeah. And so I said, okay. And he said, Randy, I created you in my image. I created the black man in my image. He's no better than you. You're no better than him. Here was my reaction. Holy crap, God just spoke to me. Okay? First time in my life that I realized God spoke to me. Up until that point, I thought God might speak to Billy Graham, the Pope, Oral Roberts. Okay? He sure didn't speak to Randy Whetstone. But he spoke to me that day, and he called me by name. And everything changed. Everything. Now, sometimes God will speak to you, and he'll reveal, or give you revelation, he'll reveal something to you, and you have a choice. You can agree with it and go with it, or you can reject it. But then there's sometimes there is no choice. And in this one, there was no choice. He instantly changed my heart. Instantly. Okay? And I mean, it was just... I mean, I come home, and I just couldn't believe, you know, God spoke to me. So this put me on a mission to have a more relationship and know more about him and learn to talk to him, learn to ask him questions, learn to get answers, learn to be guided by him, okay? And that's the mission I've been on. Make an extremely long story short, sometime after that, we basically got into a home church. Okay, where we met with this guy named Gary Stock. Gary Stock, we spent about 8 years. He poured into my life. He taught me so much and matured me so much as a Christian. It was unbelievable. And he started me on mission trips. now. Before God spoke to me in Pittsburgh, if you ask Randy Whetstone, do you ever want to leave the United States? It was no way. I haven't seen everything here yet. There's nothing out there that I want to see or I want to do. I'm spending my whole life right here, and I like it this way. Well, God had other plans. And since that time, we've done a lot of mission work in Peru, in Brazil, in Malawi, Africa. Now think about it. If I was a racist bigot like I was prior to June 6th, 1996, that was the day, by the way. I don't remember many dates, but that was it. What good would I have been? Because when we do the mission works, almost everybody we work with is black or yeah. But he knew that, so the first thing he knew, he had to change me, and which he did. Okay? He's cool like that. Okay. So, this, you know, and like I'm here today, like I said, we've been in the mission field since 2004, as we've done missionary work. Okay? And basically, since I learned to recognize God's voice, I don't do anything unless he tells me to do it, and then I do what he tells me to do. And for the last 3 or 4 years, he sent me to my father's house in McConnellsburg. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but it's a church in McConnellsburg. Bill Chilcote is the pastor. He knows Pastor Mike. You know, they're kind of buddies, you know. And last June, Lord had me buy the house over here. I'm your neighbor. Yeah, we're not living in there yet. We haven't got it livable yet, okay, for what we want to do it. But we're going to be your neighbor. And I don't know for how long, but I'm sure it's going to be a little while. And no, you cannot say anything. Yeah, yeah, go ahead. Yeah, so, and that's, yeah. We owned a hardware store for most of our lives, but then it got, because if you own a business like that, you're kind of tied up 7 days a week, you know, all year. And it got to be too much of a problem with my mission work. So God told me to sell it, you know, in 2004, which we did. And basically, I made my living off of rental properties that I had. And I worked for H&R Block. Okay, in the springtime, tomorrow is the last day. Thank you, Jesus. Okay. I love doing taxes, but boy, by the middle way, I'm ready to get out of there. Okay. So, he told us to sell all our real estate. About 3 years ago, he told us to sell all our real estate. So I basically sold all my real estate. Still have two properties that I'm trying, they're up for sale now. It's just whenever God's going to sell them, he's going to sell them. And we sold our house. December was a year, so we've been homeless and unemployed most of the time. It's awesome. Try it sometime. Okay. We live with our daughter down here in Gettysburg until we get this house done. And then we get this house done, we'll live in that while we're working on it until God tells us to buy the next one or do whatever. Okay. You know, that's his deal. So, but like she said, there's a good feeling about that house. There's a speaker system all through it. I got that all hooked back up, and there's Word FM plays 24/7 in that house. When I never turn it off. Okay, I want the praises to God to saturate that house. And like she said, there's just a good feeling about that house, and that's just awesome. So anyhow, so God straightened me out, okay, on my bigotry and my racism, okay. And then he sends me to, the first trip was to Brazil. And we had a ball. I mean, we really had a ball. And not only do you enjoy yourself and you help those people, but you get more than you give. And I don't know how that's going to play out in any of your particular lives, but I guarantee you will get more than you give. Okay? And I remember the first trip, I was by myself. Luann wasn't with me on that trip. And there was a prophecy over our trip before we left it that we were going to two different cities, and they said, you're going to have problems in the first city, but then after that you're going to go to the second city, and everything's going to be cool. Okay? And that's exactly what happened. Okay? When we went to the first city, and basically the first meeting or so, we had a crowd of people there, a bunch of pastors, and somebody in there speaking made a statement about Christians can have demons. Okay? And I don't know where you stand on that, you know, there's demons in the world, okay? And whether you believe they're around you or in you or on top of you or beside you or whatever, I don't care. All I know is you need to know they will influence you. And you have to take care of that. And so you can, I don't see any point arguing whether they're in you or outside of you or on you, because I think they're all of the above. Okay, it's like arguing over whether angels have feathers. You know, it doesn't mean anything, okay? Just understand that they influence you. And so when this happened, one of the things God was impressing upon us was honor. I'm in Mike's church today. I need to honor him. Okay? I ask the boys when I come in, what time do you usually finish? Okay? Because I want to honor him. Now, Holy Spirit trumps honor. Okay? Okay. So if he says stay longer, we're staying longer, okay? But honor. And Mike asked me to speak about Brazil, so I'm going to speak about Brazil because I'm honoring him, because that's what you do. Because if you honor who's ever in charge, you will be blessed. Okay, so when these pastors basically got up and walked out, we honored them. We didn't say a word to them. We didn't go to them. We just prayed for them. But before we left, they came back and apologized and said God had dealt with them and they were sorry for what they did. So we go to the second city. And man, everything is just going crazy. We're seeing miracles and healings and stuff like crazy. It's just awesome, you know. And we had intercession at our hotel like the day, like the last day we were going to be there. And we were praying, and God gave the one guy a vision, okay. And the vision was the team was just kind of presented to the Father in the throne room, and he just looked down on us and said, "Well done, my children." When he got that prophecy, it just blew me away. Because all my life it was like, I never did it quite right. There was always something wrong, something I missed, something I didn't do. I didn't pray for this person right, or this didn't, you know, didn't. And like this time, like everything worked. And he was happy with me. And I just sat there and cried and cried and cried. And the other guy was looking at me and he said, "Look at that train wreck there." Okay? Now, unbeknownst to him, about 6 months before that, a prophet up in Toronto gave me a prophecy, and he said, "God's going to run over you with a train." Okay? He's not going to physically kill you, but God's going to run over you with a train. It happened. So, on the flight home, it's 2 o'clock in the morning. Most flights to Brazil are overnight. You leave here at, you know, like 10 o'clock at night, and you fly all night and get there about 6 a.m. in the morning. That's how they do it. And then the reverse is true on the way back. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning. We're over South America or somewhere, you know, I don't know. And I'm sitting in a seat, and the guy, I don't know the guy beside me. And I'm thinking, how am I going to tell Luann about what happened here? how can I explain this? How can I get her to understand the power of this? And the Lord said to me, you know, Randy, back in Londrina, when I told you well done, and he said, you did everything right, and I told you well done, my good and faithful servants. I said, yes, Lord. He said, if you'd have done everything wrong, I'd have loved you just as much. Train wrecked again, okay? And I'm just bawling, you know, like my buddy says, snot bawling, okay? You know, bawling coming out of your nose. Thank God the guy beside me was asleep. At least he pretended to be, I don't know, okay? Okay? Because he just totally changed me again. And it's just been a life of him doing that. Just changing me and changing me and changing me and molding me into the man he wants me to become and guiding me towards the destiny that he has for me. And that's my goal. You guys familiar with the song, When It's All Been Said and Done, Robin Mark? When it's all been said and done, did I live my life for you? That's what I want. When it's all been said and done, have I lived my life for you? So, that's why I'm here and how I got to where I am. I'm sure everybody has their own story, which is cool. Okay. But I want to give you some things, and I told you some things about Brazil. So, we started going 3 and 4 times a year. Okay. Then we branched out into Peru. Okay. And we went into Peru. And then in 2008, a buddy of mine called me and that had taken to Brazil. And by the way, his name is Gary Nels. He is a worship leader like you have never seen in your life. But until we took him to Brazil, he was just a guy who could really sing and was good on the piano. But when we took him to Brazil, he came back a worship leader. And when he leads worship now, people get healed just worshiping. He gets words of knowledge. He'll be playing the piano and he'll say, somebody's got a tumor on their left knee. It's disappearing right now. And it disappears right now. Okay. He became a worship leader because he was obedient and went to Brazil and did what the Lord told him to do. Okay. So, but in 2008, he calls me and he says, I'm going to Africa. Will you go with me? Now, in 2008, I already had two trips to Brazil planned. I told you I had twin daughters. They were both getting married 6 weeks apart. I said, Gary, I have two mission trips already planned. Like, both of my daughters are getting married. I am so broke, I can't pay attention. Okay? And he said, I'll pay your way. I said, hold on a second. I said, Daddy, am I going to Africa with Gary? He said, yeah, I want you to go. I said, yep, I'm in. That's how I make decisions. I just ask him. He tells me, you do it. It works out super. Okay? Now, when we go to Brazil, I tell people, if you want to experience the Holy Spirit, come with me to Brazil. You are going to see signs, wonders, miracles. You're going to see healings. You're going to see just miracles that don't even have to do with healing. The last time we were there, we stayed like a little camp, and it's their spring of the year when we're there. Their seasons are reversed, okay? And the caretaker built a fire to burn some brush, and then he walked away. And it was like 90 degrees and 20-mile-an-hour winds. Well, before long, he's got a field. The field next door is on fire. It's burning. We've got a brush fire runaway. So I said to our coordinator, I said, is this a problem? He said, yeah, it's a big problem. He said, we've got to call the fire department. They're going to fine us. We're going to have to pay them. You know, this is a big problem. I said, okay. So I'm thinking, what am I doing? I thought, okay. And now we were standing here, and it was like burning up a hill away from us, you know. I said, in the name of Jesus, I command this fire to stop. And when I did that, the Lord said, don't stand behind that fire and tell it to stop. Get in front of it. Okay. So I ran around to the front of it, and I said, in the name of Jesus, I command you to stop. And the fire stopped. Now, I thought the wind would stop blowing, you know, or it would start to rain or something. The wind kept blowing. It was still 90 degrees, but it just stopped. That's a sign. That's a wonder. That's a miracle. Okay. So anyhow, that's Brazil. So when we go to Africa, now, the kind of the word on the street is like, in Brazil and South America, the miracles are really good and cool. It's, you know, you see a lot of miracles. But Africa's over the top. You know, Africa's where you see creative miracles. You know, arms grow back and people raised from the dead. You know, all, you know, so I'm going to Africa and I'm so excited. I thought, man, this is going to be so cool. We're going to see all these miracles, you know. It's going to be so cool, okay. So I go with him. And if you live in the United States, you might think you've seen poverty, but you really haven't. You go to Brazil, you'll see poverty. When you go to Peru, you'll see even more poverty. When you go to Africa, that's the ultimate. When they're there with nothing, the people have absolutely nothing. They might have partially clothed. They might have a feed sack to sleep on. That's it. That's all they got. That's poverty. Anyhow, so we go to this, and the pastors, we meet this pastor, and there again, met the pastor over the internet. This is my buddy did, okay? So when we're flying over, and I mean, it's a long flight over to Africa, you know, I say to my buddy, I said, you know, if people from the world look at us, we're really stupid. He said, well, what do you mean? And I said, well, we're flying halfway around the world to meet a guy who says he's a pastor. I said, it could be a crook who's going to knock us on the head and take our money when we get off the plane, or even worse, a 13-year-old girl having fun. And he looked at me with this look of shock, and I said, don't worry, Daddy sent us. It's okay. Okay. So we get over there, and we're riding with this pastor. And I mean, I can tell you stories forever, but he's telling me, I want you to meet this little girl and pray for her. You know? And he said, her legs are backwards. He said, I want you to meet her. So we took us to this boarding school, and here comes this little girl. And if you can visualize this, her knee joints are backwards. Instead of her legs going this way, they go out frontwards. So she can't walk. So basically, she walks, her legs are out, her calves are on the ground, and she shuffles like Yoda. And here she comes through the dirt, coming around, and I'm looking, I'm thinking, this is going to be so cool. God's going to turn her knees around, everything. This is going to be so cool. This is just so awesome, you know? And so we start praying for this girl, and nothing happens. And we pray for this girl, and nothing happens. And finally, I just give up. And we get loaded up in the van. It has a little minivan, and we start down the road. And in the spirit, thank God I didn't do it in the physical. In the spirit, I am screaming at God. You know, I'm looking up and I'm shaking my fist and I'm saying, don't you send me here and show me this without giving me the power to do something about it. Don't you do this to me. Yeah. And after about 30 seconds, I figured out, boy, you just really screwed up. Okay. And I said, okay, God. I said, I give up. I don't know why you sent me here. I don't know what you're doing, but whatever you're doing, I'm in, because I know your ways are better than my ways. And he said, well, Randy, he said, you thought you'd just waltz in here with signs, wonders, and miracles and make everything all right. And I said, yeah, because that's what I thought was going to happen. That's what I was hoping would happen. He said, well, it's not working that way here. He said, in Brazil, you build other people's ministries. In Africa, you're going to fund this guy's ministry. Okay, Lord, whatever you say. So from 2008, my job in Africa is to raise money and fund this guy's ministry. Now, it's a real long story, but basically when we went there, that pastor had a major unforgiveness problem with his bosses. He was in a denominational thing, and basically they trumped up, he had a church that was doing real good, and his bosses got jealous, and they trumped up charges on him and took the pastorate away from him. So he become an evangelist, so he didn't do this, have to pastor this stuff. But because he was an evangelist, still under the domination, every month he would have to go back and report to these guys who basically set him up and took him down and tell him what he was doing. And so when we were there, he confessed to us. He said, every month I have to go and I see those guys and I put this mask on and I smile and tell them and I love them, but I really hate them. And he said, I've been listening to you guys' message of forgiveness. And he said, I know I have to forgive them. And I said, are you willing to do that now? He said, yeah. So we prayed with him and he forgave him. Now, up until that point, he had been working on $200 a month that he got from the denomination to be an evangelist. He was averaging 6,000 conversions a year. Okay? He had a clinic that he provided medical care for under five on $200 a month. That was in 2008. Since 2008, we've funneled over $300,000 to his ministry. We now have an orphanage. We now have a hospital. We have dreams of a pastor's school, because I can plant a church every day in Africa if I have pastors to pastor. But that's the power of forgiveness. So now if you want to experience Jesus, you come to Africa. Because you will feed the poor, you will clothe the naked, you will heal the sick. You'll see thousands come to the Lord. You'll be in the dirt constantly, but you will experience Jesus. So, but back to Brazil. Typically what we do there is we fly down, we stay in a camp, we have a coordinator who is a former drug dealer. Okay? You ever notice, like, the drug dealers and the bank robbers and stuff, when they get saved, they get a lot more anointing than you do? You know, I was this good kid who went to Church of God every Sunday, had the drug problem, you know, did all this stuff on my life, you know? And these guys, you know, they kill people, they do all kinds of, and they get more anointing. I mean, what is that? But that's the way it is, okay? It doesn't mean you can't have anything, okay? But so he sets up churches. We try to divide the team into three different teams. Okay, at least three. That depends on how many leaders I got. If I know a guy I can trust to lead a team, you know, we'll go three, four, whatever we got. But if we have three teams and there's two churches, we'll go out, we'll split the teams up, and I will not speak. My job is to empower you. I've already been empowered. I can do it. You need to be empowered. You can do it. Okay? My goal is, you know, we have a couple that has went with us about four trips now. You know, I'm about ready to say, you ain't going with me no more. You take your own trip. Because they're ready. They're ready. Okay? My job's empowering. And basically what we do, we go to churches that are already established. We preach a message and whatever God tells you to do. You know, if I tell people, if you get to know pastors or evangelists or whatever after a while, basically every one of us have a message. Okay? And I don't know, like, are you guys familiar with Randy Clark? You know, Randy Clark's message is God can use a little you. That's his message. Thank God he gave it to me. Okay? Heidi Baker, her message is die. Just die and do what Jesus tells you, and everything will be okay. You know, Randy Whetstone's message is recognizing God's voice and forgiveness. The first thing you got to do is learn to recognize God's voice. And from that, everything will flow out of there. And you got to forgive those who hurt you. Okay? And just like that pastor in Africa, can you imagine he went from $200 a month? Now, here's another amazing thing. You know, I've been in this business for quite a while now, and normally it's very hard to find an honest pastor in South America and Africa. It's very hard. Normally, if I would have did that with a pastor, when I came back the second time, he'd have had a new car, he'd have had a television, he'd have had a nicer house. Okay? It's been since 2008. He still lives in the same old house. Finally got another car. Okay, we told him we'd buy another car,
Which is used.
Which is used. Okay, yeah, don't buy any, you know. I mean, but he still lives like he did. All the money we funnel into him, he gives away. He keeps nothing for himself. Okay? Believe me, that doesn't happen very often. Okay? So anyhow, and Brazil, we got, a former drug dealer, okay, who is our coordinator, speaks English fluently, okay, and has these connections with these pastors. And he's the same way. You know, we pay him so much, we pay him $2,000 to plan, organize, and take us around for 2 weeks. That's dirt cheap, folks. Okay? And he gets us a camp to stay in for free. We pay nothing to stay there. Okay? And we eat like kings. Okay? But anyhow, we go to these churches, we'll do a message, and then we'll pray for healing. And you're going to see healings like you've never seen before. I encourage, you know, when I teach the people on my team, I said, when you pray for somebody, ask them if they're healed. You know, normally in America, you got a headache, okay? Okay, Lord, you know, in the name of Jesus, take the headache away. We don't say, is your headache gone?
Right.
Okay, we don't do that, okay? Because we're afraid. I said, ask them. I said, if their pain's not going away, pray again. Do what God tells you. But you get, and we have this on video. We took my daughter down, okay? And it was the first person she prayed for. And whatever it was, they had pain in her back or their shoulder or something, you know. And when she prayed for them, you know, and she said, now, is your pain gone? And they went, yeah. And she goes, really? She was shocked. Okay, yeah. Yeah, don't do that, you know. Just go, thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Don't go, really? Okay. Okay. But like I said, you're going to see healings, okay? And the last trip, we were there 10 days, okay? And my coordinator emailed me because he said, when are you coming back? All the churches are screaming for you. They want you to bring a team back. He said, I went through and we've documented over 400 miracles while you were here the last time. 400 miracles in 10 days. That's 40 a day. And 17 members. Okay? Now, and I don't think he documented some of the stuff. I don't think the fire was one of those 400. I'll tell you another thing we did. We went into a prison. We'll go into prisons. We'll go into drug rehabs. We'll go into nursing homes, okay? We went into a prison. This prison was set up for young kids. I think it was 16 to 21. They looked 12 to 18, but I think it was 16 to 21. And men, okay? There was 30 of them in this prison, okay? And we had a meeting in there, and our coordinator, you know, there again, I don't normally plan anything. I just flow with the Holy Spirit as it goes, okay? Like we're doing today, okay? And we went in, and I said to our coordinator, I said, you know, why don't you speak because you were there. You were right where these guys were. They can identify with you, okay? And so he did. He basically gave his testimony. And while he's giving the testimony, I hear the Lord say to me, I want you to make a salvation call, okay? Now, that normally don't happen with me. One time, or when I was younger in my walk, I was kind of beating myself up because I wasn't bringing people to the Lord. You know, I was discipling people and stuff, but I wasn't bringing newcomers to the Lord. And one day the Lord, you know, told me, and sometimes the Lord's, most of the time it's just a still small voice, but sometimes it has inflection to it, you know. And this particular day the Lord said, Randy, what are you doing? And I said, well, what do you mean? He said, why are you beating yourself up for not bringing people to me? And I said, because I'm not. He said, that's not your job. I have soul winners to do that. Quit wasting my time. You do what I tell you to do. Okay. Okay. So like I said, this doesn't normally happen to me. So he says to me, you know, I want you to do a salvation call. I said, okay. So about 2 minutes later, one of my team members came over to me, and she said, I think the Lord wants. Yeah, it did. I turned myself off. He said, I want you, I think the Lord's saying we need to make a salvation call. I said, I think you're right. Go for it. Okay? So she said, okay. So she made a salvation call. 30 inmates, 27 of them gave their heart to the Lord. 27 out of 30. Now, I'm not sure. The other three might have already been saved. I don't know. Okay, but either way, now that's a miracle. When you evangelize a prison in 1 hour, you evangelize a whole prison in 1 hour, that is a miracle. That's not man, that's God. The warden came up to us and said, I am so glad you guys came here. My worst troublemaker is the first guy that gave his heart to the Lord. He said, you've made my life so easy. Okay? I don't think that was one of the 400. Okay, but I'll tell you, some of the 400, we had blind people see. Now, you have to learn to recognize God's voice, and you have to do what He tells you to do. One of the young ladies come up to me, and now, she wasn't totally blind. She was legally blind, had very thick glasses and stuff like that, and she took her glasses off, and we were face to face, and she says, I know there's a person standing in front of me, but I couldn't recognize you. That's where my vision is. I said, okay. So laid my hand on her shoulder. Said, okay, Lord, what are we praying? Lord said, kiss her on the eyes. Okay. So I said to her, I said, listen. I said, when I pray for people for healing, I ask the Lord what to do, and I do exactly what He tells me to do. I said, but in this case, He says, I'm to kiss you on the eyes. Are you okay with that? She said, yeah. So I kissed her on the eyes. I said, okay, Lord. I said, open your eyes. And so she's standing in front of me. And so she's like standing right here where this line is. And I'm by here, and I said, okay, how many fingers do I got up? She says, one. I said, how many fingers do I got up? She says, three. I said, how many fingers do I got up? She says, four. And up until that point, she couldn't recognize me when we were 6 inches away. And the lighting in Brazilian church isn't very good. I'm not sure I can see four fingers at that distance. That's what you're going to see. We had deaf people here. Lord just pops their ears just like that. It's amazing. Okay? One of my favorites was one of my team members. When you go down there, it doesn't take long. You get a reputation. Okay? In other words, you're in one church one night, and the next night you're in another church, and there's people that were in the first church there. They follow you. Okay? And word gets out. The Americans are in town. If you need a healing, be at such and such a church at such time. They brought this baby in to one of our meetings. They had taken it out of the hospital. The baby was like 3 months old, had had a stroke, was paralyzed on its right side. They had a feeding tube in it. The doctors told them, it's going to die. You know, we've done all that we can do. The baby's going to die. And so they took the baby out of the hospital, brought it to our services. Okay? My team laying hands on that baby. And that baby that was paralyzed on the right side started to kick and move its arms and legs on its right side. Its head was all swelled up from the stroke, and his head instantly went back into the right size. They said, get us a pacifier. The reason it had a feeding tube is it couldn't suck because of the stroke. Get us a pacifier. They stuck a pacifier in its mouth and it started to suck. That's somebody's baby. That's somebody's grandbaby. I'm a grandfather now. I think grandbabies are the best thing God ever invented. Okay? Yeah. That's somebody's grandbaby. Can you imagine how they felt? there was a boy had leukemia. Hair was all gone from radiation. Mother was holding him. He was like a limp rag in her arms. Okay, white as a sheet. Okay. Team laid hands on that baby. That was on Thursday night. And prayed. We come back in Sunday morning, and the kids running around the church.
Amen.
Sometimes you don't see the miracles because you're praying for diabetes or you're praying for tumors. We went into this one church one time. A couple come up, had the prettiest little girl about this high. Says to my partner, they says, "Do you remember us?" "No." He said, "Well, you were here last year and you prayed for our daughter. She had 5 tumors in her brain. And they held up, they had x-rays. There was the 5 tumors." They said, "Here's her x-ray now. Totally clear." Wow. Wow. You know, this is what you'll see. Now, why do you see that? Well, you're healed by faith. Unfortunately, in South America and in Africa, the black arts are prevalent. There is voodoo and witchcraft like you've never seen before. You know, in the United States, we have no clue about this. There's some in the United States, but nothing to the level that you're going to see in South America and you're going to see in Africa. And they've seen the power of the voodoo because it works. It's spiritual, okay, and it works. So they believe in the supernatural. In the United States, we're too rational. We have to have a rational explanation for everything, okay? This works because of this, okay? We that's our problem. Okay, we shouldn't be that way. Bible says we should be like little children. Okay? And little children don't rationalize everything. You know, when my kids were little, you know, daddy was hero. You know, daddy could do anything. When my kids were 2 and 3 years old, if I told them, "When you get up in the morning, there's going to be pink snow in the ground," they would get up the next morning fully expecting to be pink snow in the ground. Okay? Because they have childlike faith. We need that childlike faith. Okay, if we had that childlike faith, you know, we could do it. And sometimes we don't know. One night I was in Brazil, and when this little church, we had to climb up a dirt bank and everything to get to this church, you know, which is typical. Okay, crawl over a couple sewers, okay, open sewers, okay. Find this little church, about 35 people, okay, in that church. And that night when we prayed, everybody got healed in that church. Everybody got healed of everything except one woman. And she had really bad eyesight. And she didn't get healed. So when I come back to my room that night, I'm laying in bed. And I'm going, "God, you healed everybody. Why didn't you heal that woman with the bad eyesight?" He said, "Unbelief. Hers and yours." Whoa. Okay. I said, "Lord, I didn't know I had a problem with unbelief for blind eyes." He said, "Well, you do. So what do you do?" Bible says, when the guy was faced with the same thing, remember guy, Lord asked the guy if he believed, and he said, "Lord, I believe." But he was lying. And he said, "Lord, help me in my unbelief." So I just laid there and said, "Lord, help me in my unbelief. Lord, help me in my unbelief. Lord, help me in my unbelief." And the next night, we prayed for people with blind eyes, and they didn't get healed. And the next night, we prayed for people with blind eyes, and they didn't get healed. And the next night, we prayed for blind eyes, and they got healed. It took a while. Okay? You guys know all the names for Jehovah, you know, Jehovah Nasa, and Jehovah Jireh, you know. Well, you also got Jehovah Jokester, okay? Because he will play with you, okay? We had this couple on our mission team, And like I said, we go three different places, and they come home, and I'm the coordinator. I'm the guy that has to answer all the questions. And they said, you know, Jeff left his glasses at Pastor Pedro's church, his reading glasses, and we got to go get them. And that's just not an easy thing to do in Brazil with the whole team and stuff like that. And so I said, well, I'm thinking, okay, reading glasses, $5 at Walmart, what's the big deal? You know? Unbeknownst to me, they were prescription reading glasses, like $300 reading glasses. Okay? And I still didn't know that, okay? And we go to the airport on the last day, and our flight is leaving at 3 in the morning. Okay, like I said, you fly all night, you know. So we get there about 1 o'clock, okay? And most airports aren't really busy at 1 o'clock, you know. And this airport's not busy. And so when you're going there, you got to go through security. And then you got to go through customs or immigration. Okay, Brazilian immigration. Now, Brazilians speak Portuguese. So we get into immigration. And here's worship music playing over the radio in English. Okay, I mean in blasting. And there's this one woman in the immigration booth. They're in the booth, you know, she's over there. Yeah. Okay, because Brazilians dance. Okay, like in worship, Brazilians dance. Okay, and she's dancing, you know, I'm thinking, well, this is really cool. And then there's a guy sitting there like would control that thing. And I'm looking at him, and he just looks at me and just smiles, yeah. And I'm thinking, is he real? Or is that an angel, you know, okay. Okay, and so we get to the gate, okay, and now we have an hour wait at the gate before our plane comes, and we're sitting there in the chairs, you know how the airport is, you know, and yeah, trying to get this little bit of sleep or something, you know, and Jeff's sitting there, and all of a sudden he hears this clunk, and he looks down, and there's his glasses case. He reaches down and picks them up. Opens them up. They're his glasses.
He tries to get more.
Yeah. God just dropped his glasses at the gate. Yeah. I mean, like, Jehovah Jokester, you know? He'll bless you. It was something else that happened to Jeff. Like, okay. Oh yeah, well, yeah, yeah. Jeff's a pretty good dude. We belong to this Christian organization called Trace Dias, which puts on these weekends, and they one part you give people gifts. And what we would do, Luann and I, for years we bought these little aluminum crosses about this big, and you stick them in your pocket. You know, just to, when you pull out your change, you know, it kind of reminds you of Jesus. You know, we did this for years. Okay. And Jeff went through this weekend, and he got his cross, and he carried his cross everywhere he went. Okay? Now, it's in his pocket with his change. Now, they live up in Somerset, okay, Somerset, Pennsylvania. Like, it snows there, like, every month, but two or three out of the year, okay, icy. Okay? One day, him and his wife, they have an SUV, and they get an accident. They roll this SUV three or four times, okay? And when it's all done, neither one of them has a scratch. And Jeff looks in, and on the dash is laying the cross. It come out of his pocket during the wreck, out of his pocket, and is laying on the dash. God just saying, I got you, Jeff. I got you. Okay? And he's got you. Yeah. You have anything you want to say? Okay. We are going, yeah, to Brazil again, June 25th to July 5th, 10 days. June 25th to July 5th. Cost is $2,500. If God tells you to go, go. Do not let the $2,500 have anything to do with it. Yeah, that includes everything. When you leave the United States, I pay for everything until we get back. Okay? But here's what I tell people. If it's God's will, it's God's bill. If it's your will, it's your bill. So you'll know if you messed up. It's going to cost you $2,500. Otherwise, the money, he'll show up. Now, one time, one of our trips, we were going, and God told me and Luann were going, and she kept saying, but we don't have the money. We don't have the money. I said, I don't care. God says you're going. You know, so she kept going, you know. And one time it got to the point where I was tired of hearing it, you know. And I said, listen, I said, you go up to the bedroom right now, and you just flat out ask God, am I going or not? And I says, and then whatever he tells you, that's the answer. We're not going to discuss this anymore. This is the way it's going to be. So she was obedient. She went up to the bedroom. She came back down. A couple minutes later, she said, he says that I'm going, and it's already paid for. And I said, you know, and she said, but we don't have the money. I said, in the meantime, grandbaby's born. Yeah, grandbaby's born down here in Gettysburg, and she goes down, like good grandmothers do, to take care of this baby and take care of mom, you know, while they get everything situated. So, and at that point, like I said, I had left the Methodist Church, but I still would go back on Wednesday nights and teach, okay? And we had people from all over Claysburg come into this session, and all denominations. Even the Methodist pastor would come in and sit in on the teaching, okay? And so it was on Wednesday nights. And so I would come home on Wednesday nights, and Luann would call me, and she'd go, how did Wednesday night's meeting go? You know, and I'd tell her, this happened every week. Well, whatever, okay. So anyhow, you know, I go into this one Wednesday night meeting, okay, and a friend of mine from the Methodist Church, you know, she walked up and she handed me an envelope, okay. And I said, okay, and I opened the envelope, and there was a check for $4,000. Said, have a good time in Brazil, from the Methodist Church. So when Luann calls home that night, she said, how'd the meeting go? I said, it went pretty good. We talked about this, Carol gave me an envelope. There's $4,000 in the envelope, said, have fun in Brazil. She goes, what? I said, he told you it was already paid for. It was already paid for. Okay. Well, and here's the thing. You might think you know what you're doing lots of times, but you really don't, okay? When we were in this Methodist church at the street fair every year, you remember that, okay? Okay, we had a booth, and we sold funnel cakes and stuff like that and make money, okay? And they put this into a fund. And basically, they wanted to use that fund. It was called Noah's Ark Fund, and it was for building improvements or whatever they needed it, you know? And every time we'd do this, then Luann would say to them, now, we got to tithe 10% of this somewhere. And they go, no, we might need it for this, and you know? And every year, we got to tithe for a year. This went on for a couple years, you know? Luann kept saying, you need to tithe this, you know? And they say, no, we might need this for something else. Well, guess where the $4,000 came from? Noah's Ark Fund. And the Lord spoke to her and said, I was saving that for you. You are the mission. Yeah, that's another thing. We're all waiting for this big move of God, right? Right? We're all praying for this big move of God. Okay? What's going to happen? Okay? But I'll tell you what, God told me, quit waiting for the move of God. You are the move of God. You are the move of God. You are the move of God. It's going to happen, but don't wait around. You do what he tells you to do now because you are the move of God. And you might think that you're just a little old me and my little word or my deed doesn't have anything, don't have much to do. There is no such thing as a little word from God. No such thing. How many of you are familiar with Toronto? The Toronto Blessing, the revival went on, okay? Most of you, okay? Well, here's some news that, you know, I got addicted to Toronto. I mean, seriously, Lana would drive up on a Friday night, drive all night, go to church, and stay the weekend and come home Sunday and work all week, okay? Because we wanted to get God. We wanted to get in His presence so much. Well, basically, Toronto I'm talking about, I'll give you a real quick rundown. Randy Clark was a guy in Missouri who went to Toronto for a revival that lasted basically 20 years, okay, with all kinds of signs, wonders, and miracles, okay? And basically, I'm standing here because of that revival. Because with that revival, that's where I got more of our Lord. I met Bill Chilcote through that revival. Bill knows Mike. You know, all this, you know, this is, I probably wouldn't be standing here if it wouldn't be for that. Okay? But that revival would have never happened. But the night before, Randy Clark was going to cancel. He was scared. He did not want to go to Toronto. He was scared. He was not going to go. And one of the people in his church called him and said, Randy, the Lord just spoke to me and He said, tell you this. Test me, Randy. Test me, Randy. Test me now. I will not fail you. And because He gave him that word, he went to Toronto. And in Toronto, a revival took out that lasted 20 years that affected the world. The world. We would drive from Claysburg to Toronto. It's 8 hours. I remember the first time we were there. We thought we were pretty good. We drove 8 hours to go to church. Okay? So we get up there, and we go into this church, and we sit down, and one of the things, and they start talking, and they said, you know, well, just stand up and say hi to your neighbor and ask them where they're from. So we stood up and turned around and asked the guy, where are you from? He said, South Africa. It affected the world. There were people there, they would get up, you know, who hears from Europe? A bunch of people would stand up. What kind, you know, all over the world. It affected the whole world. And it would have never happened if one guy wouldn't have called and said, Randy Clark says, the Lord says, test me. You have no idea. You have no idea what one word from God will do. Don't be afraid to give it, no matter what, because it could have worldwide consequences. And it probably does. God doesn't just randomly give you words for, He has a purpose and a meaning for everything. Okay? So, what happens to you when you get back from Brazil? You have faith like you've never had before. You'll have testimonies. The church doesn't use testimonies the way we need to. Revelation, it says, you overcome the evil one by the blood of the Lamb and the word of your testimony. A testimony is, God revealed this to me, a testimony is an invitation for you, if you hear a testimony, it's an invitation for you to experience Him in exactly the same way. Now we know, you can give your testimony to lead people to Christ. And that's why you give your testimony, to lead people to Christ. Because you're inviting them to have the same experience you did, an encounter with Christ. The same thing goes with healing, the same thing goes with prophecy. Anything like, anytime you have a testimony, that's an opportunity for you to experience Him in the same way. My vision of church is not what we're seeing here today. You know, Stephanie was great doing the worship. Yeah, I loved her. She got a beautiful voice. Okay? We do worship, we take an offering, and then we have a speaker speak and teach or do whatever, and then we might have a prayer time or whatever. Okay? That's good. That's great. But here's my thing, a church. We come here on Sunday mornings, we worship, and we share testimonies. And then you go out and become that testimony. That's my vision of perfect church. You know, I believe the teaching and stuff, is there's times for that, home groups and whatever, you know, like that. But a Sunday worship service is just the time to come together and worship the Lord and share our testimonies, so that we can spread His love throughout the world. go into all the world. Now understand, go into all the world means Africa, Brazil, China, Russia, and more importantly, across the street. Right across the street. Maybe you're not supposed to go to Brazil. I don't think everybody is. But I do know everybody's supposed to go across the street. Everybody's supposed to go across the street. You know. But if he taps you on the shoulder and has you go, you know, across the big pond or whatever, you know, that's what you want to do. Now, I know you're not, these stories, they're not news to you guys. You know, I've read Pastor Mike's books, you know. But you all should write a book. We took a guy to Brazil one time. He basically hid in the back of the church the whole time. He had a book. I think it's R.H. Shambaugh. Have you ever heard of him? I might have the initials wrong. Okay. R.W. Shambaugh. Okay. I should remember that. That's my initials, R.W. Okay. Okay. And he had this book and tells about testimonies of R.H. Shambaugh, all the miracles and stuff that he's experienced. And he's reading this book and he's hiding in the back of the church. And the Lord speaks to my wife. She goes back to him and she said, Andy, the Lord says if you put that book down and pray for people, you can write your own book. So he put the book down, started praying for people, started seeing miracles happen. And you will see miracles happen. Africa, I'm just kind of bouncing to Africa for a little bit. I got to tell you this story. When I went to Africa and kind of had that fight with God, okay, and lost, okay. Another thing this pastor took us to was to this village and showed us the well that they got water out of. Now, this well was basically a hole in the ground, had a little bit of water at the bottom, kind of looked like skim milk, okay, stunk like crazy. I started finding out that 1 in 5 children will die because of the water, and they don't have any other choice. That's all the water they have. And when I saw that, this anger stirred up inside of me. It said, you know, on this day and age, there's no excuse for that. You know, it's estimated that to solve the water problem in the world would cost $10 billion. Americans spend $40 billion on Christmas alone. That's how easy we could solve the water problem. So when I came back, I started raising money to drill wells. Because when you drill wells, they have clean water. It's real simple. They're going to get down 30, 40 feet. They got perfectly clean water. Have a hand pump, you know, because there's no electricity. So I started raising money for wells. And I think it was about the fifth well we raised for. A friend of mine, they cost $5,500. A friend of mine came up to me and said, I want to pay for a well. And he hands me a check for $5,500. Okay. So I call Francis, our guy over there, and I said, okay, call the well driller. I'm mailing you money for another well. And so he went to the local government and he said, okay, where is the worst place in this region? And be like, where's the worst place in central Pennsylvania for water? And he said, they said, this village here, they have cholera outbreaks all the time. You know, it's really bad. That's the worst place. So he said, okay. So he goes to this village. Now, in Africa, everything's tribal. You have villages and there's a chief and he runs everything. Okay? So you have to get permission to the chief that you just can't go do this, you know? So he goes to this village, it's a Muslim village, totally Muslim village. So he goes to the chief and he says, can I drill a well? He said, sure. So they drill a well. And he said, now let me warn you. He said, we put a sign up at every well. And the sign says, this clean water was donated by the Lord Jesus Christ. That goes on every one of our wells. It's not donated by Randy Whetstone. It's not donated by Jesus' Lord Ministries. It's donated by Jesus Christ. Okay? So he said, sure. So we drill a well. And he says, goes to the chief, and he said, I notice all these little kids, you know, why aren't they in school? He said, well, the school's 7 kilometers away. It's too far for them to walk. They can't, you know. He says, can I put a school here? The chief says, sure. Now, a school is just shade. They just put up some poles and put mats over it so there's shade. They write in the dirt. That's all they have. And so basically it's kindergarten. They just teach them basically stuff, you know. But we send the teacher in there, and, you know, she just happened to use the Bible to read them stories. Okay? This is a totally Muslim village now. You got to understand. So comes November, I get an email from Pastor Francis, and he says, you know, the village where we put well number 5, the Muslim village, and we got the kindergarten, he said, for Christmas, I'd like to give these kids a special meal, a piece of chicken, a handful of rice, and a Coke. Now, that's another thing. You can go into the deepest, darkest recesses of Africa, and they've never heard the word Jesus, but they all know Coke. They all know Coca-Cola. Okay? Somebody, you know, Coke's been around for 200 years, we've been around 2,000. What's wrong with this picture? Okay? Anyhow, so he says, now, we have about 100 kids, and he said it's going to cost about $3 a piece. It's going to take about $300. Can we do this? Well, our mission account at that point had absolutely zero in it. But being this giant man of faith I am, I said, yeah, go for it. Okay? Now, the guy that invited me, Gary Nouse, that I told you about, you know, we copy everybody's emails back and forth so we know what's going on in Africa. Yeah, Gary emails Pastor Francis and said, you're thinking too small. Feed the whole village. God will provide. And I'm the guy who handles my, Gary, I don't got nothing, okay? Well, that was on Thursday. By Monday, I had $1,000. By Monday, I had $1,000. Okay? Now, that was that happened too quick. Till I got the email out, people had already sent the checks. God told them, and they sent them. I mean, so we got $1,000. So I wire it to Francis. Now, Francis goes to the chief and says, I'm going to have this meal, you know, and she says, no, that's too lavish a meal. He said, just buy corn and just give us corn. He said, you know, for this lavish meal, we could have 3 times as much corn, you know, and it'll feed my people longer, and they're starving. I said, okay. Now, Francis does this all the time. He knows how much corn you got to buy to feed like 100 people or 200 people or whatever. Okay, so he has this plan. He's going to go on Christmas Day, and he's going to give everybody 2 kilos of corn. Now, 2 kilos of corn is about that much right there. That's just about 2 kilos, okay? So Christmas Day, he arrives. He has a little Datsun or a little Toyota pickup truck, okay? And he's got these sacks of corn in the back. And so he gets everybody lined up, and he starts pouring corn out of these bags, giving everybody 2 kilos of corn. And everybody gets 2 kilos of corn. And there's still more corn in the bags. So he gives everybody else 2 more kilos of corn. And there's still corn in the bags. He gives everybody all they can carry. And there's still corn in the bags. He said, Brother Andy, the bags just wouldn't go empty. Now the chief's watching this. He's not stupid. He knows something just happened because you can't get that much corn out of 10 bags of corn or whatever, you know. You just can't. And he says, friend, what's going on here? He says, Jesus has given you corn. Who is this Jesus? He said, the guy that gave you the well, the guy that gave you the thing, you know. And he says, can I show a video of who this Jesus is to the chief? She says, well, yeah, I want to see who this Jesus is. Okay. So they set up a screen. They played the Jesus video. Guess what? That Muslim village is now a Christian village. Everybody in the village gets saved. Just what Jesus did. They saw the miracle. Okay? Yeah. But one guy, Claysburg, was obedient when God told him, give this man $5,500 for a well. And the fruit of that is thousands coming to Jesus. Children not dying because of waterborne diseases. They'll grow up and be Christian men. You want to defeat ISIS? There is only one way. And that's Jesus. That's the only way. You know, we can do anything with military that we want or do all kinds of stuff like that. That ain't going to solve the problem, people. There is only one way to defeat ISIS, and that's Jesus Christ. The Jesus film. How many of you heard the Jesus film? Okay. Well, the Jesus film was started back in the 1970s by a guy named Paul Eshelman. God told him to make this film of the book of Luke. And he did. And basically, it's the book of Luke put into film. Now, when we were in the Methodist church, we got this bright idea. We heard about this Jesus film. We bought a couple hundred of them, okay? And we're going to make sure every family in Claysburg has a Jesus film. So we put them in little bags, and we went house to house, and basically we'd hang them on the doorknob and run away. That's where we were, okay? You know, it's like, you know, sticking tracks in the door. You know, if you were selling vacuum cleaners and you just stuck a brochure in the door, how many vacuum cleaners do you think you're going to sell? You got to go in and show them the product. But anyhow, but that's where we were. Yeah, is it? So, and then I had a friend of mine, his kid went on a mission trip to Northern Africa, and I was asking him, well, what did they do? And he said, well, we went to this place and we showed the Jesus film, and, you know, then we'd have an altar call, and, you know, and I'm thinking, that's it? That's all you did? Well, until I experienced it. First time I went to Africa, he takes us out in the middle of the bush nowhere, and he's got this Toyota pickup truck with a generator on it and an amplifier and a couple great big speakers and a video projector and a CD, a DVD player to do it, you know. And so we go out and we set this up and we turn the speakers at 180 degrees and crank the volume up as loud as we can, okay? Because there's no communication. So these people in the villages, they hear this noise. Well, they go see what it is. Okay, well, that drawed them right in. Well, there was about 30 people there till it got dark. Now, there's no lights. Okay? So they start playing the Jesus film, and the pastor plays it about halfway through. And he says, now, okay, he says, I'm going to stop this film. And he says, you know, you go out and give a salvation call. Keep it real simple. Okay? Now, when it got dark, I saw like 25 or 30 people there. Okay? And so he stops the film, and they turn this one light bulb on, and my buddy Gary gets out there, and he gives this little quick salvation call, and he said, if you want to give your heart to the Lord, come forward. 200 people came out of the dark. 200 people. I mean, it was like, where'd they come from, you know? And then they gave their heart to the Lord. And they said, okay, now you're Christians now. See this big tree here? That's where church is going to be Sunday morning. You be there Sunday morning at 9 o'clock and be a pastor there to teach you. Instant church plant, 200 people. Boom, just like that. You can do that every day, all the time, all over Africa. Just show the Jesus film, okay, and boom. You know, it's done. Yeah. Yeah. Over and over again. A couple years ago, I got the privilege to meet Paul Eshelman in Kansas City. And there was we were staying at a hotel. They were having a thing, IHOP. Okay, you guys know what IHOP is, International House of Prayer. Okay, not pancake place. Okay, okay. And the hotel had breakfast in the morning, and I get down, and there's Paul Eshelman sitting. And I said, I walked up to him, and I said, I'm sorry to bother you, but I just want to shake your hand. I said, do you realize you are responsible for more people coming to Christ than anybody in history? Except Jesus. It's estimated that every 4 seconds somebody comes to Christ through the Jesus film. Every 4 seconds. I've seen it happen. It does. He said, I was just doing what God told me to do. Just do what God tells you to do. He thought he was making a video that some people could use for evangelism. He is changing the world as we speak. Okay. Guy says wrap it up, okay? So we're going to wrap it up. If God's telling you to go with me, you know, we'll be here for a little bit after the service. If not, you're going to find me over here at the house, especially since tax season's over tomorrow and I'm a free man again. Okay, we can be out here. I'll be over there a lot. Or, you know, you can get a hold of, you know, the boys or Mike, you know, and you get a hold of me. And but you need to know quick because basically Yeah, you need a passport, and basically we need a definite go by the 1st of May. So that's not very long. But you got to get a passport, you got to get a visa, you know, and but we'll take care of that. Yeah, we'll help you get the visa, but you got to get the passport. And if you don't have a passport, even if you're not gone with me, get a passport. That way you're ready when God says go. If you want to go to Canada now, you got to have a passport. So just go ahead and get it. They're good for 10 years or 13 years or whatever. So you never know what God's going to tell you.